وسلم: أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. وبعد، so الحمد لله، إن شاء الله we are continuing our study of the biography of our beloved Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. And إن شاء الله we will start this lecture إن شاء الله by making dua for the mother of our beloved brother Sami, who passed away last night. So we start because Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم has said that لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يحب لأخيه ما يحب لنفسه. So we every no one is a perfect Muslim until he wishes for his brother what he wishes for himself. So we wish to make dua for our deceased persons. So also we have to make dua for the mother of our brother Sami, who has just passed away last night. اللهم لك الحمد كما ينبغي لجلال وجهك وعظيم سلطانك. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد في الأولين، وصل على سيدنا محمد في الآخرين، وصل على سيدنا محمد في الملأ الأعلى إلى يوم الدين. اللهم اغفر لها وارحمها، اللهم تجاوز عن سيئاتها واعف عنها، اللهم أكرم نزلها، اللهم وسع مدخلها، اللهم أبدلها دورا خيرا من دارها وأهلا خيرا من أهلها. اللهم اغسلها من خطاياها بالماء والثلج والبرد. اللهم نقيها من خطاياها كما نقيت الثوب الأبيض من الدنس. اللهم اجعل قبرها روضة من رياض الجنة، ولا تجعله حفرة من حفر النار. اللهم ثبتها عند السؤال، اللهم قيها فتنة القبر، اللهم قيها عذاب القبر، اللهم لقنها حجتها، اللهم بشرها بمقعدها في الجنة، اللهم اجعلها في الفردوس الأعلى من الجنة، اللهم ارزقها صحبة النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين، وحسن أولئك رفيقا. اللهم اجعلها من الذين لا خوف عليهم ولا هم يحزنون. اللهم اجعلها من أهل السعادة التامة الكاملة التي لا شقاء معها يا رب العالمين. اللهم أحل عليها رضوانك فلا تسقط عليها بعده أبدا يا رب العالمين. اللهم اغفر لها ولأمواتنا وأموات المسلمين أجمعين، وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. جزاكم الله خيرا. So last week we have started you know discussing the Ghazwat Uhud, and today inshallah we are inshallah continuing starting the same Ghazwa. And as we have come to know that the number of the Muslim army in this Ghazwa was how many was the number of the Muslim army?
300.
No, in Ghazwat Uhud was 1,000. Yes, but then
70.
Yeah, then Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, the head of the hypocrites, he withdrew with 300 hypocrites. So number of the Muslim army now is only 700. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam mobilized his army, and he arranged the army in several rows for the fight. And he sallallahu alaihi wasallam selected 50 skillful archers under the leadership of Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Jubayr al-Ansari. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam commanded this number of archers under the leadership of Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Jubayr al-Ansari, which formed like one detachment. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam gave them clear commands to stay on a mountain which was 150 meters far from the Mount Uhud. And as we will come to know now, that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave them very clear instructions not to leave their place unless he sallallahu alaihi wasallam would ask them to do so. This mountain, which was 150 meters far from the Mount Uhud, was called later on the Mount of the Archers, or the Jabal Ar-Rumah, Ar-Rumah the Archers. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam spoke to their leader, the leader of this detachment, سيدنا عبد الله بن جبير الأنصاري, and he told him انطح الخيل عنا بالنبل, like drive off the horses of the enemy, drive them away from us by use of the arrows. لا يأتون من خلفنا, lest they should attack us from behind, from our rear. إن كانت لنا أو علينا فاثبت مكانك. Whether we win the battle or we lose it, just keep firm on your place and don't leave your place. لا نؤتين من قبلك, and mind that we must not be attacked from your sight. Because Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم encamped with the Muslim army just in front of the Mount Uhud, so back of the Muslim army, their back was protected by the Mount Uhud, and their right side was also protected by the Mount Uhud, and there was only a gap that the disbelievers were able to to reach the Muslim army and attack them from, and this gap was from the left side. So Prophet Muhammad ﷺ appointed this this detachment, the 50 archers, to be over this mount, the mount of the archers, so that if the disbelievers would attack Muslims from their right, from their left side, then those archers, those 50 people, were in charge of driving them away from Muslims by use of arrows. Also, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam added, telling Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Jubayr and all the 50 people with him, احموا ظهورنا, defend our back, فإن رأيتمونا نقتل فلا تنصرونا, if you see us being killed, then don't support us, don't go down this mount, the mount of the archers, and support us or defend us, just be on the mount. وإن رأيتمونا غنمنا فلا تشركونا, and if you see us are collecting the booty, then don't share in that with us, be at your place, don't leave your place. And in another narration in Sahih al-Bukhari, the Prophet Muhammad sallam told them as well, إن رأيتمونا تخطفنا الطير فلا تبرحوا مكانكم, if you see us are being snatched into pieces by birds, like we have been killed and or wounded, and that birds are snatching us into pieces, snatching our bodies, إن رأيتمونا تخطفنا أو تخطفنا الطير فلا تبرحوا مكانكم, don't leave your position on the mount, فلا تبرحوا مكانكم هذا حتى أرسل إليكم, don't leave this position of yours until I send for you, ask you to come down. وإن رأيتمونا هزمنا القوم ووطأناهم فلا تبرحوا حتى أرسل إليكم, and if you see us have defeated the enemy and trot on them or step on them, then also don't leave your place and your position until I send for you. So this was a very wise plan put by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which proved that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam possessed high skills in the military leadership, because although Muslims reached the place after the disbelieving army had already reached the place, Prophet Muhammad ﷺ was able to take positions better than the positions that the disbelieving army had already taken. And Prophet Muhammad ﷺ made the mount of Uhud to function like a shield for the rear of the Muslim army and for the right side. And Prophet ﷺ appointed this group of the archers to be on or over this mount in order to block the only gap that was available for the disbelieving army to use to go to the Muslim army and to attack them. So Prophet ﷺ blocked this gap by this group of the archers over this mount. And they were, by doing so, defending the Muslim army from the left side. And also, this group of the archers, the 50 warriors, Muslim warriors, were also providing more protection to the Muslim army, to the rear of the Muslim army. So they were protecting mainly the left side of the Muslim army, and at the same time they were providing more protection to the rear of the Muslim army. And also, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam chose a high place for the camp of the Muslim army, so that the Muslim army would be able to inflict big losses on the disbelieving. Alaykum assalam wa barakatuh. So the Muslim army was able to inflict big losses on the disbelieving army in case that the disbelieving army would try to occupy the position of Muslims, the place of the Muslims, and to approach them. So Muslims were in a higher place. So when they are in a higher place, they can use the arrows very easily. And on the contrary, the disbelieving army was in a lower place. So it was very difficult for them to shoot, to use the arrows and attack Muslims by arrows from this lower place. So this also showed the wisdom of Prophet Muhammad and the skill that he possessed with regard to, in military leadership and related things. So even this high place that the Muslim army encamped in made it easy for Muslims in case of that they are winning, so that they can easily chase the enemy, and it was difficult for the enemy to escape as well. But if loss would be for Muslims, if defeat would be for Muslims, then it would be difficult for the disbelieving army to chase them, because they are in a higher place. Also, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam made up for the quantity shortage in the side of the Muslim army. Like they were, their number was less than the number of the disbelieving warriors, and also their weapons, and they didn't have horses, for example, and so on. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam made up for this by choosing excellent group of fighters to be in the front lines. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam appointed for the leadership of the right wing of the Muslim army Sayyidina Al-Munzir ibn Amr. He was from Khazraj, he was from Al-Madina. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam appointed for the leadership of the left wing of the Muslim army Sayyidina Az-Zubayr ibn Al-Awwam, who was of course one of the Muhajirin. And also he was assisted by Sayyidina Al-Miqdad ibn Al-Aswad, who was a Muhajiri as well. And this was on Saturday, the 7th of Shawwal, in the third year of the Hijrah. Saturday, the 7th of Shawwal, in the 7th year of Al-Hijrah. So roughly 1 year after Ghazwa Badr, roughly, or a few days, more than 1 year after the Ghazwa Badr. Prophet Muhammad sallam wore two armors, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a front armor and a back one. And this shows that Of course, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam trusted Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Of course, he was the, you know, the one who trusted and relied Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the most. But still, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, al-akhd bil-asbab, you know, used to do his best as well with regard to getting prepared for war or for any other thing. So he put on two armors, and he sallallahu alaihi wasallam forbade Muslims to start fighting unless he gives them, you know, the command to start. And this also shows that Muslims are always very well organized. And this also shows that war in Islam cannot take place by individuals, but it only takes place under authentic leadership, authentic Muslim leadership, you know, having scholars, you know, and proper Muslim army, and they know very well what they are doing and what, and this is really is a good thing to be done. This is the only option, for example, to go for this war. So, but individuals are not allowed to, you know, to go for wars on their own. So even, of course, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us this as well. Everyone of the Muslim army at that time knew very well that war was going to start, because they have already gone out with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam for war. But still, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam commanded them, don't start fighting before I give you permission to start. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam also urged the companions to be firm, and he started sallallahu alaihi wasallam to stimulate them also to fight with all courage. And he sallallahu alaihi wasallam started to instill the spirit of boldness and bravery in them. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam held a sword in his hand, and he addressed all the companions, all the warriors, because Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam from the very beginning he did his best to avoid the war. But since decision has been taken and it is war, then they should do their best in the battlefield as well. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam held a sword, and he addressed all the companions saying, من يأخذ هذا السيف بحقه, who is going to take this sword from me, provided that he gives it its due right. He gives the sword its due right, or he fulfills the right of this sword. So a lot of the noble companions, they asked the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, every one of them asked the Prophet ﷺ to give the sword to him. Among them was Sayyidina Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab, Sayyidina al-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam. So all of them, they just hastened and said, yes, O Messenger of Allah, I will take this sword from you and I will fulfill its due right. But one companion, maybe until that time he was not a very well-known companion, his name was Abu Dujana Simak ibn Kharsha. He said, وَمَا حَقُّهُ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, and what is the due right of this sword, O Messenger of Allah? What is the right that should be fulfilled if I take from you this sword, O Messenger of Allah? So Prophet Muhammad ﷺ answered him, أَن تَضْرِبَ بِهِ وُجُوهَ الْعَدُوِّ حَتَّى يَنْحَنِ, that you strike with it the faces of the enemy until it is bent. So Abu Dujana said, أَنَا أَخُذُهُ بِحَقِّهِ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, I will take it and I will fulfill its right, O Messenger of Allah. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave it to Sayyidina Abu Dujana. So from this we learn more than one lesson. We learn firstly, when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam started to encourage the companions to fight, you know, with boldness and bravery, and when he held his sword and started to address them, who's going to take it and fulfill its due rights, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was trying to raise the, you know, the morale of the Muslim of the Muslim warriors, and this shows that that it is very important. You know, having a high morale is very important, and Prophet Muhammad was aware of this, and Prophet Muhammad was the best to do this, of course. And also in Islam, whenever we do any good thing, we have to do our best to perfect it. The Prophet ﷺ said, "Inna Allah yuhibbu idha amila ahadukum amalan an yutqinahu." That Allah loves that if any one of you or when any one of you does any good deed, then he has to perfect it. So, for example, Islam commands us to be merciful, and we are taught that a man was admitted to paradise because when he saw a dog, he was suffering from thirsty. He went into the a well of water, and he used his shoes to as a container, filled with water, and then he offered this to the dog. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgave this man. So Islam commands us to be merciful, and Islam commands us to reach the maximum degree of having mercy, so that we are not only merciful to human beings but also to animals. So, and when it comes to the worst, and there should be a war to to defend Muslims, to defend themselves or to defend their lands, as it was the case in Ghazwat Uhud, because the policies of Mecca, they were the ones who started aggression against Muslims and who liked to attack them in their Medina, in their city, in Medina Munawwara, the city of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So they had to defend themselves. And when it comes to this, then they had also to perfect what they were doing, which was fighting in this case. So, because if somebody is going to fight the enemy and defend himself against an enemy who is carrying weapons, then he has to do a very good job. Otherwise, he will be killed, and maybe his family members as well. And so that's why Prophet Muhammad ﷺ encouraged them to fight in the most proper manner and to very in the most perfect manner. Also, when different companions, including Sayyidina Umar and Sayyidina Abu Bakr al-Siddiq and Sayyidina Zubair ibn Awam and others, when they asked it to get the sword from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Prophet Muhammad didn't give it to them. He gave it only to Abu Dujana. Why? Because they rushed just to get the sword. Of course, this was a great honor to get the sword of a sword of the Prophet, which belonged to the Prophet. So this is one of the swords of the Prophet sallam, to get it from him sallam, and to use it for fighting. So all of them had good intentions. Of course, undoubtedly, all of them, of course, had very good intention to get the sword of the Prophet, to get the blessing of using the sword of the Prophet sallam. But Prophet sallam gave it only to Abu Dujana, because Abu Dujana was the only companion who asked Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, what is the right that should be fulfilled? What is the due right of this sword that should be fulfilled? So he was the only one who asked the question. So Prophet Muhammad ﷺ gave the sword to him because of this. Because it is not enough to have a good intention. Alhamdulillah, inshallah, all Muslims have good intention, inshallah. But this is not enough. But to understand what is the, for example, what is the task which is required from you to accomplish now exactly? What are the boundaries of this task? So to understand what is needed first, and then to do what is needed. So Abu Dujana, he understood this. So he asked the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ about what is the right of this sword. And Prophet Muhammad ﷺ told him. And then he told the Prophet ﷺ, "Ana akhudhu bihaqqi." Okay, I will get it, and I will give the due rights of this sword. So the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ gave it to him. So before going to the practical application of anything, we have to understand it very well. We have to understand what we are going to do. So that's why Prophet ﷺ gave this word to Abu Dujana, because he was very keen to know what I'm going to do with this sword first, and then he was ready to accomplish the task. So this also one lesson that we can take from this incident. Abu Dujana was a very brave man. He used to swagger at war, and which means that he used to behave and walk in a manner which showed that he was very confident. And he used to have a red band, and he used to put on this red band in his neck in wars. He was known of this, and when he would do so, everybody would know that he was determined to fight to this. So when he took the sword from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he wore his red band on his neck, and he started to walk proudly amongst the Muslim fighters. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Innaha lamishyatun yubghidha Allah illa fi misli hadha al-mawtin." This is a sort of walking that Allah hates except in a situation similar to this. And also from this also we take another lesson. Innama al-a'mal bil-niyyat. You know, like actions are judged by intentions. So because Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "La yadkhulu al-jannata man kana fi qalbihi misqalu dharratin min kibr." Aw kama qala sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that whosoever his heart has an atom weight of kibr, arrogance, then he's not going to be admitted to paradise. And Sayyidina Abu Dujana, when he took the sword, he wore the red band in his neck, and he started to walk very proudly amongst the Muslim fighters. And Prophet Muhammad ﷺ praised him, and he said that, yes, this sort of walking is hated by Allah, but not in this situation. In this and similar situations, to walk like this is a good thing, because this will put fear in the hearts of the enemy, and they will know that Muslims, at least they will know that Muslims did not fear them, and that Muslims were very well prepared for fighting, and that Muslims' moral was very high, and that they were intending to fight with all their strength and power and so on. So that's why this sort of walking is praised when it is done for sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So from this we know that the subhanallah, the intention. So if you saw someone doing something, of course we don't know his intention. So maybe his intention is different from what I think. So I must not judge him, because Allahu a'lam, maybe there is some certain reason that I do not know, which led him to behave like this. Maybe he's doing this now because of this reason or that reason that I don't know, so I must not judge him. Okay. As for the disbelieving army, general leadership was for Abu Sufyan, and he was entrusted to be in the center position of the army. And the right wing was under the right wing of the army, of course, was under the leadership of Sayyidina Khalid ibn al-Walid. Of course, at that time, he was not a Muslim yet. And the left wing of the disbelieving army was under the leadership of Sayyidina Ikrimah ibn Abi Jahl, because later on he embraced Islam as well. Ikrimah, son of Abi Jahl. And the infantry, or those who fight on foot, they were under the leadership of Safwan ibn Umayyah. And the archers of the disbelieving army were under the leadership of Abdullah ibn Abi Rabi'ah. So also the disbelievers, they did a big preparation for the fighting, of course. And as you know, they were 3,000 people with 200 horses and 700 camels, and a big number of armors as well. And the flag, carrying of the flag of the disbelieving army, was entrusted to Bani Abd al-Dar, the tribe or the family of Abd al-Dar. And this was traditionally known in Mecca. And this, from the days of Abd Manaf, one of the early forefathers of Quraysh, he was the one who distributed certain posts among different tribes or families. So this was given by Abd Manaf to Bani Abd al-Dar, carrying the flags in wars, generally. So nobody was able to, you know, to negotiate this with Bani Abd al-Dar. No other tribe was able to, you know, to take this post from them, because this was given to them by Abd al-Manaf in the past. But Abu Sufyan, the general leader of the non-believing army, he tried to do his best to encourage Bani Abd al-Dar, you know, to defend the flag more than what they did in Badr. Because in Badr, the one who carried their flag, the flag of the disbelieving army, was another Ibn al-Haris. He was taken as a captive by Muslims. So Abu Sufyan started to address Bani Abd al-Dar and to remind them of what has happened to them in Badr. So he told them, يَا بَنِي عَبْدَ الدَّارِ قَدْ وُلِّيْتُمْ لِوَاءَنَا يَوْمَ بَدْرٍ فَأَصَابَنَا مَا قَدْ رَأَيْتُمْ O Bani Abd al-Dar, you were in charge of carrying our flag on the day of Badr, and you have seen what has happened to you and to us. وَإِنَّمَا يُؤْتَى النَّاسُ مِنْ قِبَلِ رَأَيَاتِهِمْ And people are always defeated if their flags are, you know, overtaken by their enemy. وَإِذَا زَالَتْ زَالُ And if the flag falls down, then the army will be destroyed as well. فَإِمَّا أَن تَكْفُونَ لِوَاءَنَا وَإِمَّا أَن تُخَلُّوا بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَهُ فَنَكْفِيكُمُهُ Then, whether you leave it on and give the flag to us to carry it so we can you know, shoulder the responsibility of carrying the flag of the army. Or, فَإِمَّا أَن تَكْفُونَ لِوَاءَنَا Whether you do your best, you know, to keep the flag in the battlefield, or you give it to us, and we can defend our flag. So, by doing so, he knew for sure that they were not going to give the flag to any other tribe. But he did so just to encourage them to also, you know, to defend the flag as much as they could. And he was successful in doing so because they answered him, نَحْنُ نُسَلِّمُ إِلَيْكَ لِوَاءَنَا سَتَعْلَمُ غَدًا إِذَا الْتَقَيْنَا كَيْفَ نَصْنَعُ They said to him angrily, You want us to deliver you the custodianship of the flag? You know, tomorrow here means when the fight starts, you will know what shall we do. So, you know, this also with the big difference, of course, between what Prophet ﷺ did and Abu Sufyan did. But Abu Sufyan was also trying to encourage his people to fight with boldness and bravery. And just before the fight had started, Quraysh tried to sow the seeds of discord and dispute among these Muslims. And they tried to do so through two ways. The first thing that Abu Sufyan sent to Al-Ansar a message saying, خَلُّوا بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَ ابْنِ عَمِّنَا فَنَنْصَرِفَ عَنْكُمْ فلا حاجة لنا إلى قتالكم. Leave us alone to fight our cousin, Prophet Muhammad sallam, and our cousins, the rest of al-Muhajirin. Leave us alone to fight our cousins. And if you do so, then we're not going to fight you, for it is not our target to fight you. So this was a wicked plan done by Abu Sufyan. He didn't understand, you know, that al-Ansar were fighting for sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He thought that as what the, you know, some Arabs used to do, you know, they used to enter into a covenant with other tribes, and then if the tribe that they have covenant with is going to be defeated, then they were ready just to leave it and to make covenant with some other, the more powerful tribe, and so on. But of course, this was not the case was with Al-Ansar. They fought with Al-Muhajirin because they defended Islam and they defended the religious freedom of everybody, that justice is that everybody should get his chance to decide about his religion. And also they defended the truth, and they defended the Muhajirin against the oppression of the Quraysh. So they knew very well that they were supporting Prophet Muhammad sallam for a good purpose. So of course, undoubtedly, they didn't listen to Abu Sufyan, and this plan was not successful, the plan of Abu Sufyan, and he was not able to let the Ansar forsake the Prophet Muhammad sallam and al-Muhajirin. And they gave him a very disappointing and harsh answer that he didn't expect. So they gave him a very, you know, strong answer, disappointing and harsh answer, which showed different things. Their answer and their rejection and refusal to forsake Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Muhajirin, though the situation of the Muslim army was very difficult. They were only 700, they didn't have enough weapons. So now Al-Ansar were given a good chance, if this from the viewpoint of Abu Sufyan, you know, a good chance just to avoid the big harm of being killed and to enjoy the peace that they used to enjoy before the immigration of the Prophet ﷺ and Muhajirin to Al-Madinah, and just to forget about the whole matter. But of course, they didn't do so, and this was a proof for the truthfulness of the Ansar, of course, and also the truthfulness of Islam itself. Because if somebody was fighting for not a good purpose, you know, was not fighting for a good purpose, and he knew this, and then he was attacked by you know, an army of the enemy, which is so bigger than his own army, and he was about maybe to be killed, and then a chance is given to him, you know, okay, now we will leave you safe and you will enjoy your normal life. If one knew that he was fighting not for a good purpose, then he would accept this offer. But the fact that the Ansar didn't accept this offer, it showed for 100% that they knew very well what they were doing, and that they knew very well that the Prophet ﷺ was the truthful prophet and messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that it's a big loss if they forsake the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, if the loss of the hereafter and the loss of the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the loss of Jannah, and to be liable to be punished in hellfire forever, and so on. And also we learn from this lesson that the enemies, you know, the wicked enemies, any wicked enemy, all the time, they are doing their best to create divisions amongst Muslims. Because Quraysh, they told Al-Ansar, leave Muhammad and Al-Muhajirin to fight us alone and be happy and safe in Medina. But their plan was, Of course, Ansar will not to respond to them, but the plan was just to divide them, and then after dividing them, to fight al-Muhajirin first, and after finishing with al-Muhajirin, to fight al-Ansar, and then to get rid of both. So this is always the wicked plan of the wicked enemies. So also, everybody should be careful about this, because the strength and power of Muslims after the help of Allah and support of Allah, and that they follow their religion and the example of Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, that they are united as well. But when they are divided, then it is easy for their enemy to destroy them. Then, and by this, I will conclude inshallah. Then Quraysh did not give up. Quraysh tried another try to create division in the Muslim army. But this time they tried to do so through a man that was known as Abd Amr ibn Sayfi. And he also was known as Abu Amir al-Rahib, Abu Amir the monk. But the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ later on, he called him Abu Amir al-Fasiq, Abu Amir the evildoer, the evil doer. Because this man, he was one of the heads of Al-Aws in Al-Madinah, the tribe of Al-Aws in Al-Madinah. And when Prophet Muhammad ﷺ came to Al-Madinah and spread Islam there, of course, Abu Amir al-Fasiq, he couldn't tolerate this. He announced his enmity against the Prophet and Muslims in public. And then he left Al-Madinah and he went to Quraysh to rally them against Muslims and to urge them to come to Al-Madinah and to fight Muslims. So he was a very wicked man. And that's why Prophet Muhammad ﷺ called him Abu Amir al-Fasiq, the evil doer. So he went to Quraysh and started to urge Quraysh to fight against Muslims in Medina, to take them away from Al-Madinah, and then he can enjoy his leadership again in Al-Madinah. So when Quraysh came to Uhud, he came with them and he told them that his people would always obey and esteem him highly. And he told them that when he would tell his people to join him, they would quickly join him and forsake Prophet and Muslims. So his intention, because he knew that he was a very notable person in Al-Aws, a very big tribe. So he thought that when he would call the Aws from Al-Ansar to join him against the Prophet, that they would listen to him. So when the two armies were very near to each other, he started to call Al-Ansar. So he started to call them and they recognized him and they knew that he was Abu Amir al-Fasiq. He thought that he's still Abu Amir al-Rahib, but Prophet ﷺ told them about him, that now he is not al-Rahib anymore, he's Abu Amir al-Fasiq. So he told them, Ya ma'ashar al-Aws, ana Abu Amir. O people of Al-Aws, I am Abu Amir al-Rahib. So they gave him a very harsh answer because they knew what he was planning for. They said, La an'am Allahu bika aynan ya fasiq. No eyes of anybody shall be comforted by seeing you, O evildoer. So then he, of course, he was very embarrassed in front of the Quraysh, and he told the Quraysh, لَقَدْ أَصَابَ قَوْمِي بَعْدِي شَرٌّ. My people must have been afflicted by an evil after my departure. So always those wicked doers, they always change realities. So now he's telling Quraysh that his people, Al-Aws, have been afflicted by an evil after he had left them. Because he had left them, so now they are not a good people anymore. And that's why they are not listening to him. And this is the way of the wicked people. They always change realities, change facts. And when the war started, Abu Amir started to fight against his people, against Al-Aws. very fiercely, and he started to throw stones at them. He was very annoyed and very angry from them because they didn't listen to him, and they deprived him of getting back to Medina, having his leadership again. And all these tries by the Quraysh tell us that though they were their number was more than the Muslims' number, and their weapons were also very more advanced, and maybe also more than the weapons of the Muslim army, but still they feared Muslims, and they were 3,000 and Muslims were only 700, but they feared Muslims, and because they feared them, they were doing their best to divide them again. Even they are only 700, but they were scary of Muslims. And you know, always, you know, if anybody is an evildoer, he, you know, he is scary. But anyone who is following the truth and who knows that Allah is with him, then this is enough. He does not fear anybody, and he relies on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But unfortunately, of course, evildoers, they don't rely on Allah for the simple reason that they know that they are wicked people, and that they only after this world are not seeking Allah's pleasure. So inshallah, next time we continue with the Ghazwat Uhud inshallah. Okay, so now we make a short dua inshallah, and we make dua for the Bangladeshi people as well inshallah. اللهم لك الحمد كما ينبغي لجلال وجهك وعظيم سلطانك. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد في الأولين، وصل على سيدنا محمد في الآخرين، وصل على سيدنا محمد في الملأ الأعلى إلى يوم الدين. اللهم رحمك بإخواننا وأخواتنا في بنغلاديش يا رب العالمين. اللهم أمنهم في أوطانهم يا رب العالمين. اللهم أمنهم وسلمهم يا رب العالمين. اللهم قهم الأضرار والمهالك كلها يا رب العالمين. اللهم احرسهم بعينك التي لا تنام، واقلعهم في كنفك الذي لا يضام. اللهم ارفع عنهم، اللهم عافهم يا رب العالمين. اللهم عافهم في أبدانهم، وعافهم في قواتهم يا رب العالمين. اللهم كن لهم ناصرا ومعينا يا رب العالمين. اللهم اجعل جمعنا هذا جمعا مرحوما، واجعل تفرقنا من بعده تفرقا معصوما، ولا تجعل فينا ولا بيننا ولا حولنا شقيا ولا محروما. اللهم لا تدع لنا في ساعتنا هذه ذنبا إلا غفرته، ولا ضالا إلا هديته، ولا سائلا إلا أعطيته، ولا مبتلا إلا عافيته، ولا مظلوما إلا نصرته، ولا مريضا إلا شفيته، ولا ميتا إلا رحمته، ولا هما ولا كربا إلا نفسته وفرجته، ولا طالب علم إلا نجحته ووفقته، ولا حاجة من حوائج الدنيا والآخرة إلا قضيتها ويسرتها يا أرحم الراحمين. نسألك الجنة وما قرب إليها من قول وعمل، ونعوذ بك من النار وما قرب إليها من قول وعمل. اللهم نسألك خير ما سألك عبدك ونبيك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، ونعوذ بك من شر ما استعاذ بك منه عبدك ونبيك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. ربنا اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا، وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين، واجعلنا للمتقين إماما. وصلى اللهم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك، أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت، أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. وجزاكم الله خيرا، والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليماً.